Employers are required to provide three benefits that are intended to protect employees' incomes: Social Security, workers' compensation, and employment compensation. The concept of Social Security has been around for a long while and has come under scrutiny many times throughout the years. As it stands today, Social Security provides benefits at old age or disability, for dependents of retired, disabled, or deceased workers, lump sum death benefits, and Medicare. Workers' compensation provides income continuation and reimbursement of accident expenses for employees who are injured on the job. The basic concept underlying workers' compensation laws is liability without fault, meaning that an injured employee is entitled to a moderate and reasonable amount of compensation regardless of who caused the accident. A second underlying concept is that such compensation is part of the expense of production and therefore is chargeable to the employer. Unemployment insurance is to provide short-term subsistence to laid-off workers while they are looking for other employment. To be eligible for unemployment compensation, individuals must have been employed a minimum length of time in covered jobs, must be currently unemployed, and must be willing to accept suitable employment if it is offered to them. Financial security for those who retired has traditionally been viewed as a three-legged stool, with each leg representing one of the three major sources of retirement income: Social Security, company pensions, and individual savings. Although company pensions are not as common as they once were, many individual savings plans allow for employers to contribute a portion or a percentage of the employee's wages to an individual savings plan. To encourage companies to offer and for employees to contribute, Congress has offered favorable tax advantages for participating in a variety of plans. More often than before, employers are looking at ways to provide employee benefits above and beyond their standard compensation. Health benefits have long been the standard, but access to employee services, such as legal services and tuition reimbursement programs, as well as pay for time not worked, are all increasing in popularity. Paid vacations and paid holidays create the impression that employees are being paid for not working, and that the company is generously providing wonderful benefits. Consequently, vacations, holidays, personal excused absences, and other opportunities for not working are regarded as part of the benefit package. The cost of healthcare has increased at the rate of 2 times the rate of inflation. Because costs are becoming so high, companies have been forced to make changes to their medical benefits in order to reduce costs. Managed healthcare refers to a variety of strategies to reduce costs. Employers can choose from health plans that offer them minimum cost control while offering the employee maximum freedom of choice, to health plans that offer them maximum cost control while offering the employee minimum freedom of choice. It has also become necessary to put the individual employee back in the driver's seat when it comes to their health care costs. Consumer-directed health care plans are programs that have been approved by Congress and qualify for special tax treatment. These plans allow employees to choose the benefits they would like or need, such as flexible spending arrangements and health savings accounts. Benefit programs provide a dignified way for employees to receive a relatively secure and constant level of income regardless of illness, accident, or time away from work. It is not only for humanitarian reason, but employers provide benefits because they believe the welfare of their employees is enhanced by them. Benefit programs are based primarily on three philosophies: sharing the risk of accidents and illness, forced savings for retirement or bad times, and sharing the cost of special services. Since employee benefits represent a major cost for most companies, efforts to analyze and control their costs have become increasingly important. 4 methods to analyze the cost of employee benefits are the annual cost method, cost per employee per year, percent of payroll, and cents per hour. Companies should take the time to audit their benefit plans to ensure that they and their employees are receiving the best advantage from these programs while keeping costs under control. Employers use a variety of communication strategies, including employee handbooks, employee portals, agent enrollment sessions, newsletters, lunch and learn sessions, benefit booklets, and FAQ material to educate their employees on what benefits plans are offered. However, employers are also required to have a summary plan description that describes each welfare program offered. The SPD must include the eligibility requirements, a summary of benefits, the procedure for claiming benefits and appealing denials, circumstances that could result in a loss of benefits, and the individual's rights under ERISA.